honest. And being people, being people think that the best way of being able to achieve that is to have an attack on the democratically elected leader of the Labour Party. Now, don't get me wrong, I think we should have lots of democracy within the Labour Party, but you know what? We've had it. We had the democracy a year ago, and people turned that in their hundreds and thousands and voted for Jeremy Corbyn, who I'm proud to say is a member of Unison. So when you see what's going on with our public services right now, when you see that our junior doctors are having to say that they're going to go on strike, because people are trying to say that they're having to work 7 days. I've got news for these Tories. It's a 7-day National Health Service already. And yet we get Labour MPs who see the Labour Party as a career choice. They see it as a career choice. One day an MP, the next day a banker. I did say banker, didn't I? Or they see the Labour Party as a marketing opportunity. All we need to do is make sure that the communication is right, to make sure that the nice, shiny pictures are taken of people, men in suits. That's what we've got to do, apparently, to sell the Labour Party. Here's an idea. Let's stand up for what we believe in. Let's stand up for what we believe in. And if people say that it comes from a lunatic, left idea to say that we should have affordable housing for people, or that we should have a national health service that doesn't depend on how much money you've got in your pocket, or that we should end the privatisation of all public services, or that we should simply say there should be no more nuclear weapons in this country. Because I know that when I go out and talk to people about these things, when I say we need peace, we need housing, we need people not to have to do 2 or 3 jobs just to put bread on the table or keep a roof over their head, I know that when we go out and talk to people, they know what we're talking about. They don't want the shiny, pathetic pretense that some people seem to be coming out with. What they want is honest, straight talking politics. And I'll tell you this, anybody who says to us, anybody who wants to pick an argument with Jeremy Corbyn about equality, anybody who wants to do that needs to pick an argument with all of us, because I've been there, when Jeremy's been there, when everybody else has said that the sort of things that we're standing up for in terms of equality for women, equality for black people, equality for lesbian and gays, equality for the disabled, equality for young people, people said those were lunatic ideas as well. Well, again, we should all be proud lunatics if that's what it takes. Now, I say, ideas that people understand, and I am an organiser, and I know that sometimes we have to go out and talk with people who don't want to hear what we've got to say. We have to go out and have difficult conversations with people and say to them, you know, this is where we stand, we're proud of where we stand, here's why we believe what we believe in, and have that conversation. And I know that's not always easy, but it's what we have to do. We have to go out door to door, community to community, cafe to cafe, pub to pub, workplace to workplace, wherever it takes to make sure people hear our argument. We all know that the media is not on our side. They're not going to report this stuff properly. Bless you all in the media down here, of course. Anyway. But we all know that it's going to take us to go out and do it. I'll finish with this because Jeremy's always been really clear about this. This is not just about Jeremy Corbyn. This is about what sort of society we want to live in. Are we prepared for the same as we always have? Or is it a time when we've got to have a fundamental shift in favour of working class people in this country, an irreversible shift in favour of working class people? I think that time's now. Shining armour to come round the corner to the rescue, they will never come. It's about us. We are the ones that we've been waiting for. Nobody else. We are the ones that we've been waiting for. Thank you so much. Good luck.
And this vehicle we're standing on today, this vehicle has travelled the length and breadth of Britain. I've stood on this platform in wind and rain and hail and snow. We've been everywhere with this, and when it's in support of the firefighters and any disputes they're having, they always play Ring of Fire. Today they promised me not to play Ring of Fire. Oh, we're going to get it, are we? Oh, Lord. Here it goes again. This fire truck has been quite amazing. It had its first outing in our campaign a year ago, when so many people attended a rally at Camden Town Hall, we had to have 5 overflow meetings. The last one was about 1,000 people in front of this truck. And that was the one where there was a picture of a group of teenagers trying to climb through a window of the town hall to get to a political meeting. What does that say about our My reply was quite simply this. It's not that young people are not interested in politics, it's that the political establishment was not interested in their hopes and our lives. And I want to also thank Dukera for what she said. First speech on a public platform, absolutely brilliant. Well done. Of a whole generation to be well educated, to do their best, but also to put something back into the society that's given them the chance. That is a decent socialist principle. Thank you, Shakira, for what you said. That history of radical struggles, the history of those that campaign against their own self-interest, but against the injustice, the immorality, the inhumanity of the slave trade in the 18th and 19th century. That is a radical tradition that runs through the working class movement all through Britain. We should remember our history, learn from it, to make sure that we understand our rights come from those that went before us. And it was great that Bishop Desmond Tutu himself came here to thank the people of the region for their work in opposing the slave trade long before he or any of us were born, but recognising that that history of solidarity knows no frontiers and knows no boundaries. If we believe in human rights and justice, we believe in human rights and justice without boundaries. We want to extend those rights to everyone all around the world. International solidarity is important. And so, at one level, this is a campaign for the leadership of the Labour Party, obviously. But it's also a campaign about how we do politics in this country. We have now adopted a principle of most of our rallies being held in the open air, in town centres like this, and streets and parks, and all kinds of places. And I think it's great, because the weather is perfect all the time, except when it rains. And it means that anyone can come along, anyone can hear what we have to say, and hopefully join in things afterwards. So that there are no limits, there are no boundaries. Come on in. Think and share ideas of decency, respect in politics, and how we can do things very differently. campaign is like living in a parallel universe. I read the media some days and I read very unkind things that are said, quite shocking, some of them. And I read the levels of political arithmetic that have been developed. You can't appeal to the poor because you won't win an election if you do, because the middle class will be put off by your appeal to the poor. You can't only appeal to this group, you've got to appeal to that group. The endless triangulation of ideas that suggest you have to compromise on every principle you ever believed in. I simply say this, we live in a world that has become more and more unequal. The richest are getting richer, the poorest are getting poorer. The narrative that we've been fed by neoliberal economics for the past 40 years is that the rolling back of the role of the state in public services is inevitable, the impoverishment of the poorest is inevitable, and the cost of the next generation is unchangeable. The idea being that somehow or other, if you create a more unequal society, a more unequal economy, it might grow a bit, it might grow a long way, but there's going to be a pool of poverty and a pool of disillusionment underneath. And the next generation shouldn't bank on the idea there's going to be free education, there's going to be a free health service, there's going to be decent housing. They should make their own arrangements and go to one of the privatised enterprises in order to decide on their future education, future healthcare and future pension. Well, I don't think it is right for this generation, us, me, my generation, to say to the next generation, we've had it all right, really sorry about that, but we're pulling up the drawbridge on you, you're on your own from now on. So it is about running the economy in a different way. It is about the inclusion of everybody in our lives and in our economy. And when you talk of poverty, when you talk of homelessness, when you talk of disillusionment, you see in the faces of people who are really up against it. People say to me sometimes, you're under a bit of pressure, aren't you? And I say, no, no, absolutely not. For two reasons. One is, whatever personal abuse is thrown, I don't care because I'm not replying. I'm not getting it. Secondly, real pressure is when you can't feed your children, when you haven't got a roof over your head, when you don't know if your kids are going to be all right or not, you don't know if you're going to remain in the private rented flat you're in because you're on a 6-month tenancy. Real pressure is trying to survive in a world of plenty when you are yourself reduced to poverty by an economic system that doesn't care about you. Inclusion of all in our thinking, the thinking has to change. The economic thinking has to change. We've had 6 years of austerity in Britain. We've seen the cuts in the health service, we've seen the cuts in education, we've seen the growing debt level of young people leaving university, we've seen some appalling work practices developed. We've seen the deregulation of society and all the consequences that go with that. And after the leadership election last year, the first thing I did was ask John McDonnell to take on the job as Shadow Chancellor of the Exchequer. And I'm very grateful for John for taking it on. I'm very grateful for John for what he did and what he said as soon as he was appointed to that position. He made it very clear to our party conference, quite simply, austerity is a political choice, not an economic necessity. Back, 6 years of underfunding local government, 6 years of frozen wages in the public sector, 6 years of underinvestment in housing, 6 years of underfunding of the health service, we're left with problem after problem after problem. How do we take it forward? We say the way forward is to invest in a growing economy. Invest into a national investment bank in infrastructure investment, housing investment, and investment in high-tech, cutting-edge jobs and industrial development, so that when we have the brilliance of scientists, technicians and researchers bringing forward new products, new coatings, new ideas. Develop them here. Develop the industry here. Manufacture them here as well. Put the money into it because we all benefit from it. So fundamentally, what John is saying is that there has to be a growing and developing economy. But that is best served by a democratic society. Because our democracy is, yes, elected politicians, yes, elected councillors, yes, it is elections for quite a lot of public positions. But there are also problems. Too much of the democratic decision making is top down. Too much of it is done from a golden circle around Westminster, around some universities, around some businesses. Too much of it actually completely excludes the brilliant skill, ideas, information and knowledge of lots of other people who may not be in some very senior prominent position, but nevertheless have very good ideas that should be heard. So I want democracy, which devolves power from Westminster, democracy that empowers local government, democracy that empowers people in their own communities so that they can take good and wise decisions about how things are done. That also requires a fairness in public expenditure across the whole of the UK. Democracy about how things are done. I stood for election a year ago, and it wasn't about me. It's not a personal thing. It's not anything like that. It's about all of us wanting our party to represent all of us and be open to all of us. And people say, well, all this message is all very well, but it really has no public appeal whatsoever. Well, I just say this. Over the past year, we have won all the parliamentary by-elections we've faced. We've won all the mayoral elections we've faced. We beat the Tories in the local government elections. And we recruited 300,000 members to the Labour Party. Of life. And when communities come together, things happen. You can come together and say, well, there is a delay in seeing the doctor, there is an overcrowding in the school, there's a shortage of housing, there's a problem about fixing the roads, the park should be better run, there's lots of things. And you could turn around and blame each other. You could blame the nearest minority for the shortage of this, the shortage of that, the shortage of the other. And you can create a final maelstrom of universal condemnation, suspicion and hatred. But you know what? At the end of all of that, you would not have built one school, trained one nurse, employed one doctor, built one house, or made anything better than anybody else. But when communities come together, things change and people achieve things. And I like to see this enormous growth in the activities of our party, the activities day to day of our party, as a microcosm of the kind of open, participative democracy we all are determined to see in this country. So we've set a number of principles around this campaign. There's bits, I won't go through them all because they take too long. But if I just mention a couple. First of all, health, healthcare. If you look across any city, you'd see terrible levels of health inequality. The longest life expectancy is usually in the richest areas, the shortest in the poorest areas. The levels of poverty and inequality lead to bad health. The NHS can't solve all of that. There has to be other decisions made as well. But the NHS, as a principle, a health service free in the point of use as a human right, is the most precious thing we have in our society, and we will never give it up. And so, I say to Jeremy Hunt today, the junior doctors that he is locked in combat with, he should see them as the allies of all of us who want an NHS free at the point of use. Yeah. They are the ones who support the health service as the people that need treatment from it. And then there is another aspect of the NHS which is terribly underfunded and has to change, and that is the question of mental health in our society. A quarter of us in our lifetime are going to go through some kind of mental health crisis. It may be a level of stress, it may be lots of things. We may get through it with the love and affection of our partners, our families, our friends and our neighbours. We may get through it. We may be lucky and get immediate counselling with the NHS, or we may get the therapy and treatment we need that's needed by the NHS. But too often that service is not available. Too often people that need that help are told to wait 6 months for it. Too often the only thing that's available is a drug therapy instead. And too often the levels of prejudice in society, by each of us, by employers, by newspapers, by the media, by communities, mean that those who are going through a crisis feel frightened to talk about it. And sadly, too many young men end up taking their own lives because of that sense of deep isolation of the crisis they're going through. We can do two things. One, ourselves, and other, by all of us. First, ourselves, is to change our mindset, change our attitude, and reach out to those going through a crisis and support them in the way you've probably supported yourself. And make sure that our National Health Service forever remains free at the point of use and is properly funded to make sure that we don't see it as a health service of last resort, but a health service of universal port of call, first port of call for all of us. Many around the world envy our NHS, and they say to me when they visit this country, "Wow, I wish we had your NHS." And I say, well, it's constantly under threat. So let's make sure we support it, we defend it, we end the privatisation, we end the treat the staff properly, and we bring the services back in-house. There are so many other areas of policy that are so important. I just want to mention a couple of others. Shakira talked about education and talked about her hopes. The problem we have is that for the first time for many, many years, school budgets have been cut. For the first time for many, many years, many working class youngsters are not now going to university because they've got no support, there are no longer any maintenance grants, the cut in EMA, and all that has contributed to a re-elitisation of our education system. We all invested in our universities and our colleges. We all invested in an education system to be there for all. Let's make sure there's a funding system that makes sure every student that wants to and can get to university can go there and not be saddled with a lifetime of debt. Wanting to undertake apprenticeships and apprentice training, also get paid properly while they're undertaking it. No longer the youth rate for minimum wage, no longer the apprentice rate, which often ends up with exploitation, but instead good quality training and apprenticeship for all, with a qualification at the end of it for every young person. The other end of the scale, the lack of opportunities for preschool facilities for so many very small children is a very bad thing for all of us. 15 hours a week is good and better than nothing. We need much more than that, because all children need to learn to socialise and grow up together, not necessarily in a totally educational environment, preschool, but in an environment where they come together, enjoy each other and socialisation. So I want to see a national education service that ensures all the way through, from children up to adulthood, there are educational opportunities. That there is an adult education service that allows people to return to education later in life rather than being rationed out of it. And that through the culture policy we put forward last week, local authorities and the Arts Council and theatres and art galleries are all properly funded. Because in all of us, there's a poet, there's an artist, there's a musician. It is retired. There is all of that. Let's not just have high culture. Let's have good quality music, good quality theatre, opportunities for young musicians for all. The creative economy is a valuable economy in itself, but it's also good for the sense of cohesion it brings to the community. So our campaign is about, it's also fundamentally about the kind of society we want to live in. If you think back, before the miners' strike, there was good quality jobs in a dangerous environment. Well paid, secure jobs until Margaret Thatcher and the Tories came along. The same applied to so many other industries. I'm sorry, I don't normally bring personalities into my speech. I do apologise, I won't do it again. And then you look at Shirebrook Colliery in Nottingham. Shirebrook Colliery is now the site of Sport Direct, a place where the Select Committee on the House of Commons said the working conditions were dangerous, the working environment was dangerous, the underpayment, the exploitation and all the other things that were there. The company has now been forced to pay £1 million back in unpaid wages, but we have to go a lot further than that. We have to end 0 hours contracts. We have to end the inequality. We have to bring in right to work and the right to be represented. That is what Nottingham Direct is about. So whilst this Tory government is pursuing an economic strategy which creates greater inequality, that's attacking our Human Rights Act, which will remove our own rights and remove our ability to criticise any other country that is abusing human rights, we are offering something very different. We're offering an economic strategy which includes all and develops all parts of this country. We're offering a sustainable idea, an environmentally sustainable idea on house building and the industrial developments as a whole. We're offering the idea of greater inclusion in politics. And you know what? It's very exciting because it's bringing so many people together. So, the media might attack us, many people might attack us, but I tell you this, there are many people who say to me, I want a decent house for my children. I want my grandchildren to be able to go to university. I want to know that there's going to be social care for me when I get older. Many people are saying to me, they want the values that founded our NHS, the values that founded our welfare state, updated into the 21st century. So we challenge the whole economic notion of cascading poverty from generation to generation and instead cascade investment and opportunity and hope and optimism from generation to generation. Concluded at the 24th of September, the Labour Party conference will take place. There will be policy debates and discussions, and there'll be plenty more of those. But I tell you this, we are going to be out there from day one onwards, from then, to every community in this country, saying, we don't believe that any part of Britain should be left behind. We don't believe that any community should be left behind. We do believe there should be a strategy reducing and removing inequalities in our society, giving real hope and opportunities in our society. So no more the cuts in disability benefits. No more because they're suffering from a crisis in their lives. An attitude of inclusion, an attitude of development, an attitude of expansion. That is what is so exciting about politics. It's fantastic, the meetings we're having, the rallies we're having. But it's also fantastic, the opportunities we've got. And we've already changed politics in Britain. We'll continue changing politics in Britain so that everyone's lives can be changed for the better by sharing things out in a world of peace, justice and humanity. Thank you very much.
So that was long. That hurt a little bit. Because I was just like standing up, holding the camera on quite a bit. But yeah, still back there. But yeah, just sending everything.